Now that is a warm welcome, and I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to everyone to Google's headquarters for Europe, Middle East and Africa. My name is Fionnuala Meehan and I'm head of Google Ireland, and I want to extend a warm welcome to everybody watching the live stream on Universal Pictures Ireland YouTube channel, and everybody in the room today. So we have our very treasured customer, Universal Pictures, in the audience. We have media, and we also have our MC for today, Sinead Burke, and we have our very special guest, SAOIRSE RONAN. So Europe, Middle East and Africa is represented here in Google Ireland with over 75 nationalities, but it gives me profound pleasure to welcome two stellar female leaders and examples of great female talent from Ireland back to Google Ireland to the Foundry here this afternoon. So last year, 2018, was definitely a year when we heard less heard voices speak up. We heard that across society, we heard that across business, and we saw that theme permeate TV, literature, and cinema. And so I don't think there could be a better time for a movie like Mary, Queen of Scots. Now, it might take some of us back to our junior cert history, or even our inter-cert history. But in fact, it is a fantastic story of two strong female leaders who strived to do the best for their people and definitely encountered challenges and struggles along the way. So it opens nationwide on the 18th of January. If you can't wait for that, there are plenty of fantastic trailers on Universal Pictures Ireland YouTube channel. We really hope that you enjoy the chat this afternoon. Please use the hashtag Mary Queen of Scots if you feel like it. And the last thing I'll say is please give a huge warm welcome to our dear friend here, Sinead Burke, writer, academic and broadcaster. Thank you all very much.
It is such a joy to be here. What an incredible way to spend Friday afternoon. Thank you all so much for being here, and thank you to Dave and Sandra for enlisting me for what might be the highlight of my 2019 already, and we're only a few days in. I am such an admirer, as many people in this room are, of the woman who's going to be joining me on stage shortly. I first had the great privilege of meeting her many years ago when we were both ambassadors for the Irish Society of the Prevention of Cruelty to Children, particularly for their anti-bullying campaign. What I love about her is she's unpredictable. The choices that she has made since she was only a child, from atonement to now, and the causes that she stands behind and advocates for, and the voices in which she amplifies in her global position is nothing short of awe-inspiring. I won't lie. I'm a little nervous. Hopefully she's not in the back of the room. But today what we're going to be discussing is culture, femininity and feminism, the importance of the political era and how that shapes culture, and a little bit of fashion too, because she is wearing the most sensational ensemble. No, really, wait until you see it. And on that note, ladies, gentlemen, and anybody who sits elsewhere on the spectrum of gender, would you please welcome Miss SAOIRSE RONAN. It's sensational, isn't it?
I was at the back of the room, by the way.
Oh, were you?
I heard every word.
Did you?
I did, yeah.
That's unfortunate. It's purvey léger, by the way. I've already asked. But I think, you know, we read so much about you and the work that you do, but what I really want to know is, how do you define yourself, both personally and professionally? Thank you for the water.
No very welcome. Nice glasses, Google.
Aren't they?
Very nice.
They have a product called Google Glass.
Oh,
it's not that.
Can you take a sip? How do I define myself?
Yes.
I don't know. I think probably like most 20-something-year-olds, yeah. I'm still figuring that out. I'm like, who am I? No, seriously, who am I? I think work has always... It's been something that I've done for so long.
Yes.
And I did definitely get to a point a few years ago, and it's something that I'm still aware of, where I really, really love it. Mm-hmm. And it's something that I've always known. And it's something that's I have grown up with. But I also got to a point where I thought, oh, is this sort of all I can do?
Yeah.
And I don't know if, I'm sure other people have had that in this room, where you're sort of like, it's great to have work, but you also don't want to just be defined by that one thing either. So it's just, it's an interesting thing when, for me, when I did reach that point and sort of started to give, I suppose, the rest of my life a little bit more time, how relaxed I became about the work and how it all sort of fed into each other and made everything a bit more enjoyable. I mean, I think with work, it's something that I do take very seriously when I'm doing it, and kind of, I'm definitely a perfectionist, but also, I don't know if any of you saw Olivia Colman's acceptance speech at the Globes the other night, where she was like, I don't know what to say, but thank you. And she's, you know, literally one of the best actors in the world. And I think there's something really amazing about just sort of going, oh, I just learned the lines and do it, and that's sort of it. And it's nice to, you know, almost go at it from a sort of child's approach, where it's
and
still
just have that curiosity.
Play. Yeah, because it's play, and it's, you know, it's imaginary, and there's something really wonderful about being able to just like disappear into another world. So you have to kind of remember that too.
And you said there that it's something you've always wanted to do. Was there a moment when you were a child that really articulated that?
Yeah, when I did Atonement, mm-hmm. which I've probably told you about before, and I was 12 when I did that, so I was only a baba, and it was the third film that I had done. Started out in the clinic, that's how it all started, with Amy Huberman and Chris O'Dowd and all that lot. And
quite a
and
cast.
I know, well, yeah. So many people started out on that show.
It's like Neighbours.
Yeah, it's like our neighbours in a clinic.
You and Margot must have had so much to talk about.
Yeah, yeah, we did, we're the same. But with Atonement, it was the third thing that I had done, and I just found myself in this company that were so incredible at what they did, like all of them, every department, and the film itself was so exciting. And I obviously totally adored Joe Wright when I was growing up, and it just felt like a dream. And I remember there was one scene that actually got cut from the film. I'm going to talk about that. But it was a scene between Kira and I, and it was the first time I was sort of properly asked to be emotional and to cry. And he was really amazing at sort of getting me into a place where I could do that. And something about like being able to just like access that.
And transform yourself.
Yeah, it was, even as a kid, was really like liberating. And it was that, I remember finishing that day and I said to Mum, I was like, I have to do this forever. I love this so much.
What did your mum say?
She was probably like, oh, geez, here we go. Another one. My dad's an actor as well. She's got two of them in the house now. No, she, you know, both of them were always so supportive. It was something that I just loved. So.
And having those female role models, I got to see Mary Queen of Scots just after Christmas. And one of the things that I was really struck by was this kind of notion of leadership. So you both play women who kind of sit, I think, on opposite ends of the spectrum as regards to behaviours.
Yeah.
You know, Queen Elizabeth is so masculine in her definition of power. And Mary Queen of Scots is so feminine. And I just kind of wanted to know a bit about how you got into that process and kind of how it shaped you.
Yeah, I mean, so I had signed up to it when I was 18, and we made it when I was 23. So about like, it was about 5 years after I had signed up to it. And loads of people have been asking me, like, do you think it would have been a different film if you had done it still in your teens? Yeah. And or would I have been a different Mary? And I really think I would have been. I think, like, I'm so happy that we made it when we did, because it was really important to, as you say, to show that Mary expected to be the leader that she wanted to be, and expected to get that sort of respect from the people around her. But she was a woman, yeah, and she enjoyed being a woman. And I also enjoy being a woman. So, and that was something that, you know, is still new for me. Yeah. You know, at that age in your early 20s, you're like, oh, it's all quite new. And
but we're living in an era where we get to even redefine what that is and what it means to be.
Exactly. And also, like, you know, from the ages of like 18 to 24 or 5, I feel like there just haven't been many characters put on screen that are female. And that was a frustration that I had in my late teens, that for some reason they weren't being written about, and I didn't know why. And like, for me, at this point, that's been the moment for me where I've been like, what's going on? And everything's sort of happening to you, and you're trying to take it all in, and it's like an exciting and really scary time. And, you know, that was no different for Mary Stuart.
No.
And so to be able to sort of be going through that myself and also honour that experience by playing someone else was really exciting. So,
and so much of the film, despite having two female protagonists, is quite male dominated.
Mm. But lots of boys in it.
No, but when you were filming, you and Margot spent a lot of time apart. Mm-hmm. So what was it like trying to work within that kind of landscape where you're trying to be this feminist leader despite everybody around not looking like you?
Yeah. You mean me personally?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it was so interesting, actually, because so they kept the English court and the Scottish court apart. So because Margot and I didn't want to see each other. Not that we don't like each other. We hate each other.
It's what happens when you're in a soap opera. Everything becomes real
women,
life.
Women, they just don't get on.
Quote that out of context.
No, she did all of her stuff separately and I did all my stuff separately. And so for both of us, our courts were predominantly made up of other blokes. But, you know, fortunately for me, I had four other girls who play the four Marys in the film. And these were real people. These girls were the same age as Mary Stuart, and they were with her from the age of 5 when she had to flee Scotland. So it was during the rough wooing, and Henry from down south was like, I'm going to destroy Scotland because I didn't get what I wanted. And Mary's mother sends her to France to be with her family. And these girls come with her and they grow up with her. And so the first rehearsal that I did months and months before we started shooting was with the girls. Mm. One of them is actually my best friend, Eileen Higgins. And we became so close. Yeah. And so we would rehearse with the boys as well, which was wonderful. But we noticed that when we were on our own, there was like a different confidence that came out. In the same way that like when a bunch of guys are together, they're, you know, agents. It's the same with girls. Smarter agents. But girls are the same. Yeah. We're, you know, dopes when we're together because we're able to just be whatever we want to be. And
but some of the most important moments are in the film are things that are happening perhaps to you, and you see it through the reflection of the expressions on that kind of group of women.
Exactly.
Because they're privy to moments of domestic violence and everything that's kind of happening to Mary. It's really extraordinary.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I really love in the film is the costuming. And it seemed, at least from my perspective, quite intense in terms of the corsetry and...
Yeah. Tight.
Yes, tell me about that.
Very tight. No sparkles.
No jumpsuits.
We did have a little bit of sparkle actually, but no jumpsuits.
No jumpsuits. Then what
like
loss.
I wouldn't have been able to sit like this. I basically, myself and the girls and Margot and Gemma and all that lot, we couldn't sit on chairs that had backs to them because Alex Byrne, our costume designer, is wonderful, but she's a real perfectionist and obviously and really wanted it to look pristine. Yeah. And so we couldn't sit down. So we had these little swivel stools that we sort of had to lift all of our skirts over and like squat over the stool and then just drop. And we'd balance ourselves on these stools. And we did that for months and months on end. So it wasn't comfortable.
No. But being an actress is so glamorous. Squatting.
Yeah. But I have to say, there was something about having those restrictions with the costumes that you were wearing. To when you navigated your way around that and sort of like found your groove with it, you sort of settled into the character a little bit more, basically. And we worked with choreographers and stuff
in order to make that work. And has that kind of experience of costume shaped how you wear clothes now and what you choose?
That experience?
Well, just in terms of it being so functional, not that you're going to be wearing corsets.
I'm wearing like waist trainers.
Looks great, you'd never know.
But you know, it changes your shape.
Yeah. How long did it last for you? Like a couple of months afterwards?
About like a month and a half. I had this little hourglass, like a little Kardashian thing.
Not that that's what we're encouraging or empowering our audience to do right now.
No.
But you wore the most...
I wore a lot of denim.
Yeah.
Everything was made out of denim. So I think
But you wore a dress for the Golden Globes that was kind of armor-esque?
Mm-hmm.
And in terms of just seeing that in your choices?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, it's... Elizabeth, who's my stylist, is... a big film buff, and she watches anything that we have coming out that we're promoting, and she's a real sort of storyteller herself. So she's very good at mirroring whatever I'm wearing with the film. So I guess we did probably do that a little bit.
I think it comes across really powerfully when you see it holistically.
Good.
But she's like, Elizabeth is doing her job. Elizabeth is on Instagram. I'd recommend that you follow.
Elizabeth's amazing. Elizabeth.
Both accounts. But one of the things that interests me most about this film is the current and the political climate that was happening around it. So there is a scene in the film in which you get your period.
Yeah.
And the director really had to fight with producers in order to keep that scene on screen, that they wanted to leave it in the editing room, according to Josie. And what is the difference between working with, particularly on set, like female directors when it comes to telling stories through that kind of authentic lens?
Yeah, I mean, there are little details like that. I can't think of many other films that have shown that, actually.
No. I couldn't name one.
But when I think about, like, even when I was younger, I don't know about you, like, nobody around me would say the word tampon or period or, like, anything like that. A few nervous laughs out there. And it's still a new thing to actually show something very natural and very regular on screen.
Literally and preferably.
Once a month.
Yes. For those who don't know.
Yeah. Comes with mood swings. So there's, there's obviously an innate understanding of a very particular experience, a female experience that you can only get from another female, obviously. Yeah. And just to even think that has some importance is something that, if somebody doesn't go through that, like the opposite sex would be overlooked naturally. Yeah. Unless you've grown up with lots of women or whatever. Yeah. So it does. There are things like that that even maybe for me, I hadn't even really thought about it before. Yeah. Like, oh, it is really important to show this in a film. I think at the end of the day, I've worked with female directors who are quite masculine and others who are very sort of more sensitive and delicate.
Yeah.
And the same with men. I've worked with one, the director I'm about to work with, Francis Lee, is like the most sensitive, lovely man, and he's about to direct two women who are in love in a film, and I don't think I could be in better hands.
Yeah.
So I think it depends on the person, but certainly with moments like that, it's wonderful to have a female come in and go, no, we should show this,
I was reading an interview with Josie, the director, and she said, the whole overarching narrative of this film is the politics of women's bodies. And it didn't really resonate with me until I saw the film, how it was so important, particularly here in Ireland, and I'm so grateful that this is happening here in Ireland, with all that we have gone through as regards to this politics of women's bodies and policing it. Was that part of your kind of consciousness when you were doing the performance or now when you're promoting the film and the stories that you're telling?
Yeah, I mean, you know, yes, I do think it was something that we were conscious of. I think also for me, though, as an actor, it always needs to come from an emotional place, mm-hmm. and that hopefully that, you know, organically can become something political or something that's a statement. But for me, it has to come from an emotional place. And I think that, you know, the repeal vote happened after we mm-hmm. had made the film. And so after being immersed in that world for a few months where you're playing a character who has ultimate power that will be taken away from her at the drop of a hat as soon as she has a kid, mm-hmm. has a son, which it did, it just made it even more personal, actually.
Yes.
Even though, of course, I'm very protective over my own body anyway, to have played someone who didn't have that, you know, I don't know, who basically wasn't afforded that.
Yeah.
It just felt like there was more to fight for now, you know.
Absolutely. And we've talked a lot about the various different circumstances that you found yourself and how hard you have worked. And there are lots of young people in the audience here who are from various different careers in terms of film and television, and they want to see themselves reflected in you in years to come. Is there anything that you would say to them? No pressure, but, you know, their career depends on it here and now.
Their whole life. Are just people from all...
Well, if you would like to give advice for both, sir,
I don't think I can.
No, we can set up an advice column right here and now.
What advice would I give? I honestly think that, like, with anything that you do, if you're lucky enough to get to do it and it's something that you love, there is a lot of it that is down to luck and being in the right place at the right time. Yeah. And honestly, and I think anyone who's like doing well in what they're doing, regardless of the industry, will say that it was like one person, like either one person who believed in me, one person who like championed me, or someone who just gave you a chance. And I was really lucky I was very, very lucky that I had a dad who was already acting. So I was already introduced to that world from an early age. But like, you know, there's a couple of people like John and Roz Hubbard who are Irish casting agents who I don't think I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. But I think once you start work and focus and love for what you do, and honestly just a really, really good work ethic is what will get you through it. Not that it should be something that you're dragging yourself to bed for every day, but like, you know, I can only speak as an actor and someone that does what I do. You know, you'll have very early mornings. When we were doing Little Women, we were getting up at 4 a.m. every day. And you just do it because it's just what you do, you know, and you're very, very lucky to do it. And but you need to have a focus there too, you know. And I really, really admire people that like just give it their absolute best, you know. And you also want to surround yourself, as you do as well, like surround yourself with other really great people that will actually challenge you and make you work harder, you know.
Because I think you need people who are your greatest champions and cheerleaders, but you also need those people in your life who are very quick to tell you perhaps when you've taken a step wrong or your thinking is in a direction where it shouldn't be.
And have like your mom told you to wear that shirt today.
My mom told me to wear this shirt today.
You need your mom to tell you to wear the
shirt. I got this for Christmas. And this morning I was planning what to wear and I sent a text into the family WhatsApp group. She's probably watching this now and I'm going to be in so much trouble. Thank you, Saoirse.
No, that's all right.
And she said, why don't you wear that shirt? So I'm wearing the shirt. Isn't it lovely?
Good shirt.
You're all hired. Thank you so much. Hi, ma'am. but I think it's exactly that. And I'm very fortunate to be now getting into a position where I have to use, and I want to use, the platform and the opportunities and the network that I have to make that difference for other people. Because I am not in my early 20s. I'm in my late 20s.
And oh, God.
I know, the terror. Still a millennial, but in late 20s. And now it's, what can I do? How can I be those people who have been so good to me? And that's both publicly, privately, and just finding that time. It's so, so important.
Yeah. And also someone said to me recently as well that, like, it's really wonderful that we're so sort of in touch now with, like, you know, mindfulness and how we feel and the health of our mind and things like that. But also sometimes you can get too in your head about things and you can become too obsessed with, like, what's going on with you. And someone said to me that, like, put attention and energy into the people around you that really mean something to you. And I think you get so much back from that. And I think that applies to work as well.
Well, one of the things that I did last year, it was almost my New Year's resolution for 2018, was to turn that monologue off in your mind, because you yourself as an individual will never say hurtful things. Like, people, strangers would never say the things that often we say to ourselves. Right. And by turning that off and by putting your trust and confidence in the people to support you, it makes such a difference.
Yeah.
But we have to go to some questions that Googlers put together.
Ooh.
Yes. Looking around for all the Googlers with lanyards, we're going to go to these ones first, and then we're going to go out. So, with the trend of remaking classics, this is my best presenter voice. It's not very strong.
It's good.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
It's
good shirt, good voice.
My mom is going to love you. Yeah. And or creating a sequel or prequel. What classic would you like to play a role in the remaking of or creating a follow-up to?
That's a very good question.
Isn't it?
Oh my gosh.
The Googler in the audience is like that.
So, I just don't think they should ever remake it. I think they have actually made a sequel to it. Oh no, I know what I'd do.
Oh.
Change my mind.
Good.
Different film. And you'll never know what it is. Yeah. It's in my monologue.
I'll find
it. And you
don't
know what that is.
Guess what the question for the interview later on is going to be. So,
I would pay money to be in a sequel of Bridesmaids.
Oh.
Hands down. Hands down.
Do you know who you need to ring?
Who?
Your pal from the clinic, Chris O'Dowd.
Oh my God, Chris O'Dowd, yeah.
He can make that happen for you.
Yeah, with the ugly carrot.
See?
Yeah.
I'm so glad I'm helping with your career.
I know, thank you. You'll get a cut.
Oh, yeah. It's fine, it's fine.
You and Chris.
Yeah, and they followed up with, like, P.S. What's the best swag bag you've ever gotten from an awards ceremony?
I'm going to be honest. Some of the swag bags are... Is this bad to say that, like, they're not
We're being live streamed, so...
You've got... Well, it's too late now. A lot of them have, like, dog food in them and skincare. But, like, stuff you've never heard of. So I haven't used a lot of it, but it's been very good for Christmas. To just go, do you want... I don't have a dog, Serge. Well, just, you know, happy Christmas. I think the best bit of swag that I have gotten... It wasn't in a bag, technically, but it was at Sundance, Film Festival. And because it's, like, on the slopes, you get a lot of outdoor gear. So, like, really good jackets and boots and things like that. And they just give it to you. And they give it to everyone.
So you use that when you come home to Ireland?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it's so cold. Yeah. So bloody cold.
And on the set, assuming that everything is meticulously planned, is there still room for you to be creative? And how do you achieve it?
Well, it depends on the set. It depends on who your director is, really. I've been very lucky that most of the time I have been able to be creative. And I do quite like sort of working within the confines of something. I like having boundaries, actually.
Yeah.
Like, Wes Anderson is very good at that. He's like, this is what it needs to be. But then within that, you can sort of play a little bit. And Greta Gerwig is really like that as well. Mm-hmm. And has gotten more like that even on the film that we just did together. So
amazing. There's your answer.
Great question.
Great question. And then, I'm just being an echo now. I should stop from that.
You should stop.
Yeah.
No, I'm doing it to you.
Oh. We decided earlier that we were twins. I can't remember why. Oh, because we both have bobs.
The same. Because I've got that shirt.
Oh, that's why
your
my mother
gave
bought
me that.
You're
shirt.
An influencer. You're an influencer. I see it now. I'm hoping for this later on.
Yeah, yeah.
Who would be a person you'd love to play in a film if it got made in the future? So they're asking for specifics, so you can't answer Bridesmaids to this. And why?
So who would I love to play?
Who would be a person you'd love to play in a film if it got made in the future, and why?
In the future?
Mm.
I could play you. I'd have to dye my hair.
So you would have to dye your hair.
I don't know.
I could write it. You could star in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You could direct it as well.
Yeah. Oh. I'm not sure this is going to get made.
No.
No.
Who
so besides me?
Who would I want to play? I don't know. Oh, well, I really think they need to make a film about Countess Markievicz. I think that would be really
cool. There you are now. That might have more chance of being made.
Yeah, maybe. Mm. That'd be quite cool to do something like that. Or Queen Maeve. I don't know. Someone Irish.
Peg Sayers.
So I can just use my own accent.
You play Peg.
Play Peg.
Little headscarf, Aran Islands. Think.
There's I can see so it many now. Options,
There's
really.
There's so, well, you might need to write something first.
No, you're going to write it.
Oh, I'm going to write it.
You'll write it.
Oh, I'm glad we've sealed the deal.
Yeah.
This is...
I'm glad this Googler has brought us together, creatively
yes.
speaking.
Yeah. How fascinating 2019 is going to be for both of us. And on that note, we're going to open the floor to kind of a couple of questions. So, raise your hand. Hello. Oh, good catch.
That yeah, microphone.
I was, saying, I was terrified you were going to throw that from quite a long distance.
Hello.
Welcome, first of all.
Thank you.
So having worked in the industry for over a decade now and with so many different people and so many individuals, you must have notched up a few awkward moments over the years. So if you could share with us the most... the most embarrassing experience that you've had on set.
The most. The most. just pick one. Just.
Do I have to say who it is? No, I don't.
Oh, no.
I met someone. I've met them multiple times, and it's been very different every time. And I was a huge fan. I don't know what I should say. It's more on me. But I met someone that I loved growing up, and it was for 5 seconds that I met her, and then we were all at a party. You were maybe there, actually. I think you might have been there.
Oh.
And I think I was working at the time,
yeah.
And I was a bit tired, I think. Maybe a bit hormonal, who knows?
This is it.
And maybe a little bit drunk.
Right.
And I got so emotional afterwards, and I was like sobbing in the corner because I was like, she just meant so much to me growing up, and it was so good to meet her. And I had a friend of mine and another person with me that were like trying to comfort me for ages and ages and ages. And apparently they wrote about it the next day. They were like, Saoirse was seen sobbing in the corner after she met so-and-so. That's probably, I don't know if she even saw me cry. But
if that's your most embarrassing moment, I'm not going to reveal anything live on stage.
There's been anything else.
No?
I don't think so.
You're like Mary Poppins, practically perfect in every way.
I don't think there's been anything else. There probably has been. But I can't think of
You'll
anything.
You'll sit on it. I think we have another question on this side of the room. Somebody had their hand up.
Oh, my God.
Oh, catch. Hello.
Thanks, Alex.
Good catch.
okay. Who would you say is the most famous contact in your phone right now? And can we call them?
The most famous contact in my phone. I have Bono's email. He's famous. So I hear.
I've heard of him.
So I hear.
He sings, does he?
Yeah, no? he does. I don't know what he does.
No.
He's got the sunglasses.
Right.
He's
Anna? No.
Yeah, no. Probably, yeah, someone like that, I'd say. But, like, I wouldn't be texting loads of famous people.
You're not texting Bono? Looking for sunglasses?
No, but I do, I'm looking for...
He'd be able to help.
...them to write a song about me.
Oh.
I'd love that. How great would that be to have someone write a song about you?
But you've been in music videos, so this is the next logical step. You don't just want to be in...
A whole album written about me. Please.
Any artist in particular?
Probably because she's my favourite person, Stevie Nicks.
See?
But that's never going to happen.
Well, you've made it into the universe now, so who knows?
Maybe I could replace... You know the way... Hasn't Lindsay Buckingham been fired from Fleetwood Mac? So maybe I could replace... I can't play the guitar or anything, but... I could just do that in the corner.
I think this is your audition tape. I think you've got it. We had another question.
Thank you.
So in the spirit of where we are today, so what was the last thing you Googled and the last thing you watched on YouTube?
What was... Who is making that noise? anything dodgy. What was the last thing that I Googled? I should have brought my phone down with me. I think the last thing I Googled, right, I don't know who's saying Bros after the screaming stops. Has anyone seen that? Isn't it amazing? It's this documentary that BBC did about Bros getting back together for one concert, like a couple of years ago or whatever. And it is honestly like telly gold. It's amazing. And so I've been telling everyone about it. And so I'm Googling it all the time, like getting trailers up and stuff like that. So that's probably the last thing I've Googled and the last thing I've watched on YouTube. Bros. Seriously, watch it. It's brilliant. It's like The Office, but sad.
There's kind of a famous stigma that actresses play the daughter and then disappear until they're old enough to play the mother. Do you think with like people like Greta Gerwig and Patty Jenkinson, do you think that's enough to kind of shift that stigma, or do you think things like inclusion waivers need to be mandatory for studios?
I would hope that naturally happens. Maybe, I mean, people are really, really pushing that, definitely. Like, I've honestly been very lucky since I started work and when I was a kid that, like, the very first director I worked with on a film was a woman. And I continued to work with female directors since I've started. So that hasn't been an unusual thing for me. And all of those women, basically, there just needs to be more of them, more female directors and writers. So that, more so than anything, that like what we were saying about the whole period thing, that they can just reflect other people's stories and they can represent a little bit more. And to be honest, I don't know why anyone wouldn't want that, because it just means when you go to the cinema, you've got more of a choice. Yeah. It's not just going to be like a bunch of action films about some boys, or even a bunch of action films about some girls, but like there's a little bit of everything. I do think it will start to change. I actually do think it has started to change already, thankfully, like even since I was 18, where there were only roles like that. There were only roles for a daughter or a sister or a girlfriend, and it was just a bit boring, to be honest, especially if, you know, like I had been lucky enough to be playing really, really great roles up until that point that were just really interesting, and then they just stopped. And I don't think that's the case as much anymore. I still think there's too few of them, but I think we're heading in the right direction, definitely. And I think what's been happening over the last couple of years too, with people like Greta and shows like Big Little Lies and Girls, honestly, TV to me has always been more progressive than film anyway. When you think of like Roseanne and like Laurie Metcalf and all these girls just like drinking a beer and having a chat, they've always been really wonderful at that. But I think there's a sense of community between women in film now that they're just, it wasn't encouraged before, and it really is now. So, and I think from that will come really great work.
But seeing you mentioned Big Little Lies there, I think it's also actresses realizing that this was the historical landscape, and somebody like Reese Witherspoon setting up Hello Sunshine and then partnering with organizations and film productions and different actors, whether it's Kerry Washington, and making these roles happen that they weren't.
Because that's what it was, is that like, there was a role for like one actress. There was the role every year for one female actor, and that was it.
Yeah.
And so no wonder there was competition, because if everyone in Google was fighting for one position, you'd be like, get out of the way. You know, you would.
Absolutely. And then the challenges that come about as we talk about intersectionality as a society. What does that mean if you're not a straight, white, able-bodied, middle-class woman? You know, and how do we find that diversity that exists in audiences on the screen? I think we have time for one or two more questions. Con, we have one here.
Oh, he's got the orange.
I think Connor had his hand up first. Oh, sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm being incredibly rude. My siblings are optometrists, and I didn't see you. Please go ahead.
Hi, Sisha. Thanks for coming. Jan McEwan's book, Atonement, was my favorite book, and you were amazing capturing just that role. And I saw you after in On Chesil Beach, incredible again to capture the tension, torment that the actress had. I just saw Colette with Kira. And before I see you in a mass production like this, I'm just wondering what type of cinema do you prefer? Those more independent movies or those big, massive productions, and why?
To work in.
Yeah.
I haven't done like huge blockbuster films. I do think it'd be quite fun to do something like that. just because I haven't done it before. I think for me, ironically, when you're on a smaller film as a director or a writer, I think you've more creative control a lot of the time. Mm. That doesn't mean that films that are slightly bigger don't work out as well. Sometimes they do. But like, I grew up doing independent films, and I like small films. I like the atmosphere on an indie film set most of the time, because it's just, you know everyone, and you haven't got a studio breathing down your neck. And sometimes they can be really, really supportive, and they can give you all the money in the world to do what you want to do. But I think in general, you get more freedom when you're doing a smaller film. And I also just really like small films. Like, I like with The Favourite, I'm sure most of you have seen The Favourite and stuff. I like things that are just sort of simple and not kind of overly dramatic. I love the big popcorn films too, but in general, they're the ones that kind of get to me. And indie filmmakers are really good at making that sort of stuff. So, yeah.
So great to see Element Pictures behind The Favourite. Connor, did you have a question?
I stand up? Okay. Hi. From one Carla person to another, thank you for representing Carla so well. Now, with Americans, I can be like, yeah, Saoirse Ronan's in there. They're like, oh, okay, I've heard of it. You just mentioned telly. You were just at the Golden Globes, which is a film and TV award show. Have you thought about going into quote-unquote prestige TV or scripted telly? And if there is a show that's on now that you'd like to be on, is there one that you've got in mind or would just like to do as a fan?
Yeah, I mean, be quite cool to do a True Detective, I think. they haven't had a girl do it yet, have they?
Oh.
When you think about it.
I see.
What else am I... what am I watching right now? There's a show... Veep. I love Veep. I love Big Little Lies. I love that there's just loads of really great roles in it. I think I would do a bit of TV if it was the right thing. I think if it was maybe a limited series. I think I would. Maybe not right now. I do really like film, and it is different. It is sort of a different medium in a way, where like you're telling a story in a different way, and I just like something being this sort of like complete little thing that you can immerse yourself in for a couple of hours and then it's done. But yeah, I think I would like to do telly one day. I love Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. Maisel.
Have you watched Schitt's Creek?
I wasn't going to say it because it's shit.
It's spelled differently.
Did someone tell you that I've been
watching that? I am obsessed with it and cannot wait for season 5.
Schitt's Creek? Oh, you all know. Okay. I thought nobody knew about it.
Eugene and Dan Levy.
They're brilliant. Like, it's so brilliant. Good. That's the show I wanted to mention, but I didn't know if because it was live we
it's
were allowed.
It's spelled S-C-H-I-T-T-S.
It's a name.
It's a name of
a name of a man.
Rural village in Canada.
Yeah.
That they inherit the deed of.
It is genius.
Catherine O'Hara, you could be her relative.
Could I?
Think of the wigs and the costumes.
I know. Keep them apart. They don't like each other.
If you haven't seen the show, that
it's
will
really
be
good.
It's
I love that one. That's the one that I'm watching at the minute. Yeah.
See, so you could.
And Succession is another one.
Oh, I haven't seen Succession.
That's the HBO show. It's really
You could be in Scandal as like an Irish ambassador.
Oh.
A diplomat.
You could just like really, really polite on the outside, but like a monster on the inside.
It would be such a reach.
But she's actually really sneaky.
See, you could do that. I think we don't have any more time, but I'm so glad that we have really fulfilled all of your career for the next 10 years.
Thanks.
Been here. But it has been such a joy to have you home and to talk to you. And your questions and your interest and your curiosity has been mesmerizing. Thank you so much for your attention. And thank you so much for being here.
And thank you for also, like, I'm sure you're all aware of what Sinead is doing, but she's really, really flying the flag for us, and we're so proud of you.
No, you're so kind. Thank you so much.
Here you go. Huh? You go.